February, I shared a message here called Who's in Charge? Remember that? You need to go back and watch that. Who's in Charge? Because it laid a foundation for how we're called to operate here in Heaven's Invasion. And so, you know, what we're doing right now, you know, is good. We're making progress. We've come a long way. But there's a whole lot more that Papa wants for us to understand so that we can begin to really live it out and function when we gather. You know, the court thing, court of heaven thing, that's part of it. But every week, there's an opportunity for him to take us in a whole other level, right? In terms of what happens when we gather. So I encourage you to go back and watch that.
Yeah.
I think it was February 2nd, called Who's in Charge? So here's a question. Ready for a question? Right? What's the one thing that we do now here on the earth that we're going to do for all eternity?
Worship the Lord.
Woo! Yeah, exactly. Worship. We're going to worship the Lord for all eternity. Isn't that amazing? And last week, the Lord kind of prompted me to go back and look at some teaching that I had done years ago on worship, because I felt like he wanted for us to kind of have a little refresher on worship. So tonight and next week, and more next week, you're going to be amazed what God has shown me about what worship can look like here in Heaven's Invasion. Because just like the previous message was called Who's in Charge, this message is called Who's Leading Worship? Okay? We all come out of, you know, the quote-unquote traditional kind of church environment, which is still, you know, going on, where this is the norm, right? It's like, oh, we have a worship team, and you know, there's a worship leader or worship leaders that are on that team, and they're going to lead worship. Well, guess what?
No.
But I won't get into that tonight, because that's going to take too much time. But so if you have your Bibles, John 4, 23 and 24, one of the most amazing passages about worship that we've ever gotten from the Lord. And Jesus was talking to the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, right? And having this conversation with her about worship and what she thought, you know, what they did, the traditions of worship and whatnot. And so in these verses, Jesus says, a time will come, and I'm reading from the Amplified, so there's a lot of extra stuff here. The time will come, however, indeed it is already here, when the true, genuine worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, or reality. For the Father is seeking just such people as these, as his worshipers. God is a spirit, a spiritual being, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, or in reality. Right? So this is what Jesus is teaching us about worship. And the thing that we need to understand right from the beginning, right, is that worship is a priority for the Father. How do we know? Because it says he's seeking worship, right? Actually, he's not even seeking worship. He's seeking worshipers, right? And one of the verses that I love that illustrates this is actually from the Old Testament. It's 2 Chronicles 16:9, which says, "For the eyes of the Lord move to and fro throughout the earth, that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his." Isn't that beautiful? So you get this picture of the Lord, you know, just looking and seeking and you know, keeping his eye out for people who've really given their hearts fully to him. Now that doesn't mean that, you know, if you haven't yet fully done that he's like, well, I don't care, you know, later for you. No. But the idea is that this backs up the idea that Jesus is saying that the Father is seeking, right? That he's seeking. See, we don't think about God as needing something or seeking after something, right? You think of God, he's got everything. Oh, he's complete, he's infinite, he has everything he needs. But yet Jesus said that he's seeking. And what's so interesting is that the word Jesus uses here for seeking is the exact same word that he uses when he says, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. or seek and you shall find. That's the same word. It's this idea of going after it, not giving up, but going after something that you just need it. You crave it. There's this idea of craving in that word seek. So it's a pretty intensive word, right? He uses it when he's talking about the shepherd who leaves the 99 to go and seek for the one, right? He uses it when he said, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. So this is some really powerful stuff. And it's also, believe it or not, the same word that Peter used in his letter when he said the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So this is a powerful word. And Jesus uses this word to describe the heart of the Father seeking. It's like, I'm not satisfied. There's something missing, something lacking that I want. I'm going after. That's the Father. Isn't that amazing? And so it's not surprising that Jesus, when he came into the temple, remember what he did when he came into the temple? He took a rope, right? And he began beating on these people that were in there selling their stuff, right? They were selling stuff. They were trying to get people to, you know, buy and sell, and they were making money off of it. You know, the money changers, right? Oh, you can't use your money. You got to use our money. So you give the guy $1, right? And he gives you 50 cents back. Seriously, this is what was going on. These guys were given money that was not equal to the value of what you were giving in. That's how they were making their money. They were the money changers, right? And so this is what was going on. And so Jesus, after he whipped them and kicked them out and everything else, he said, is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you've made it a robber's den. So what's the deal here that connects prayer with worship? You know, what's the connection? Can you see a connection between prayer and worship? Exactly. Worship is a form of prayer. Did you realize that? Worship is our connecting with Him heart to heart, right? And so when Jesus made this statement about the temple, about the gathering of God's people as being focused on prayer, we can also read into that it's focused on worship, right? And that's a priority for the Father, okay? And so in Acts 15, we have this really awesome prophecy being fulfilled when it says, after these things, I will, this is verses 16 and 17, after these things, I will return and I will rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen, and I will rebuild its ruins and I will restore it so that the rest of mankind may seek the Lord and all the Gentiles who are called by my name. So, what is the deal with the tabernacle of David? That God would say, I'm going to restore the tabernacle of David. Why was that so special? Anybody know?
Open to everybody.
It was open to everybody in what way?
Presence of God, worship. Everybody could enter.
Okay.
As opposed to the old covenant where only the priest could go in.
Exactly. Right? When David set up his tabernacle in Jerusalem, see, here's the thing. Everything David did was totally illegal. I mean, it really was. It was completely and utterly illegal because the temple was in Shiloh. The temple where the priests would do the sacrifices and everything else was in Shiloh. It wasn't in Jerusalem. So when David got the Ark of the Covenant back from the Philistines, right, and figured out how to actually get it into Jerusalem, poor guy that reached out and grabbed it and was fried instantly, right? They finally get the thing into Jerusalem, and he puts it in the middle of an open tent. I don't know how open it was, but it was right there. You could walk in and see the Ark of the Covenant. Now, if you had tried that in the other temple, what would have happened? You would have got fried, exactly. Because it was put behind that veil. It was the Holy of Holies. Nobody could go in there except the high priest once a year with the blood of a perfect lamb to be sprinkled on that mercy seat, right? So, but here's David. He, because he was a man after God's heart, He was one of those that God had been searching and seeing and had realized that David was one whose heart was wholly the Lord's, right? He allowed David, you got to see this, he allowed David to take part in a dispensation that was not his to participate in. He allowed David to experience what life under the new covenant was going to look like.
Wow.
Because of his passion, because of David's passion for God and the worship. David was a worshiper, right? He was a man after God's heart. And so God allowed him to set up this temple where the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God, was right there for everybody to see. And that wasn't even enough. What did he do? He set up a whole thing of teams of worshipers and prayers and everything so that it's almost like if you go to the house of prayer now, right, where they've got these two-hour slots and you have a worship team, you have prayers, right? Scott, you were deep into that for a while, right? I was also part of that for many years. And so that's really the model. That he would have the Levites, and he'd have the musicians and all these people, and every, you know, so often they would switch, a new team would come in, and they'd be worshiping and praising God in that tent, right there in the presence of God with the Ark of the Covenant. Isn't that amazing? Totally illegal, but that's what they were doing. And so God was so blessed by that, that he prophesies, I'm bringing that back. See that right there? That's what's going to happen under the new covenant. That y'all are going to be able to come into my presence and worship me without any hindrance. Nothing's going to be able to stop you from experiencing my presence. What the Lord is saying, prophesying. And so the tabernacle of David, the whole concept of that, is something that we get to participate in every time we come together as a body to worship. And you also have that when you're by yourself. But you know what? There's a different dynamic at work when we come together. You notice that? I can have a great time in the presence of the Lord by myself, and I do. But somehow when we're together, it's like the anointing, the presence gets multiplied. It gets accelerated and amplified and everything else. It's just an amazing thing, right? So this tabernacle has been restored for every believer to participate in. We'll talk a little bit about that, okay? Now, here's the thing, right? Jesus said that the Father's seeking, he's craving after, and a lot of people, when you think about this, the Father's seeking, we think, well, he's seeking after our worship, he's seeking after our praise, he's seeking after our prayers, he's seeking after stuff like that. But that's not what Jesus said, did he? He said the Father is seeking what?
Worshippers.
Worshippers. He's seeking people. He's seeking after those who will come into his presence, who will connect with him on a very specific way, right? So he's seeking people. A worshipper is a person. He's not seeking any kind of activity or task or function. You got to see this. He's not seeking after what we do. He's seeking after us, right? So, you know, and that's what's so crazy, because Jesus could have really said anything here, right? He could have said, oh, the Father's after your, you know, your prayer time and your reading the Word and, you know, all these different things. But none of that's there. See, Jesus said the Father's seeking you as a worshiper, right? So it's not whether you go to church every Sunday. It's not how much you give, you know, how good you are following the rules. All these different things, not even in view here. It's who you are. How he values you coming into his presence. So, and another thing is, you know what? He's not seeking a preacher. He's not seeking a five-fold minister. He's not seeking somebody with a degree, you know, or a title or position. It's open to everybody, right? He just wants all of us to come and experience his presence, right? So, what actually is worship. You ever think about it? You ever kind of, I tend to analyze things, just part of my nature as a, you know, part of my teaching gift. You know, I like to analyze and, you know, kind of make sure I understand it and break it down, right? So And this is why I love the Greek language so much. It's so picturesque, right? In the Greek, the word that's used for worship literally means to kiss the hand. To bend and kiss the hand of someone. It's a posture of reverence, right? Culturally, they would understand it as doing this, right? Coming down on your knees. And in many cultures, I should probably go up here and do this so you can see this. In many cultures, this is what they understood through this word in the Greek. Asuneo is actually this. How many people all over the world do that multiple times a day?
Oh my goodness.
Right? There's a whole religion that forces their people to do that. How many times a day is it?
Three.
Is it at least three times?
Yeah.
Right? And here we are, right? As sons and daughters of the Most High.
Come on.
And we get to do that whenever.
Amen.
It's not because it's been prescribed, you know, as a duty. Religiously, it's like I love my papa so much that I can get on the floor and just lay out in his presence. You ever do that? You ever just lay out in his presence and feel that weight of his presence on you? It's like, oh, I'm not sure I can even get up. Right? But that's what happens. And that's the idea that this word carries of worship. It's just so intimate and so, you know, powerful in its emotion and the meaning behind it. You know, if you understand what this is, you can't do this just kind of flippantly. You know what I mean? It's not just like, well, I think I'll worship now. No, this is oh God, here I am. I love you. It's like you're engaged. You're engaged, all of you is engaged in worship. That's the picture here, you know? Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not in any way trying to make someone feel bad because, you know, you don't feel like you're very demonstrative, you're very quiet, you know, and you like to sit and just, you know, enjoy the Lord that way, okay? You can do that, and He'll still love you, and no one's gonna judge you. If anybody judges you here, you let me know about it, because we're not having that, okay? But we need to recognize that there's more. There's a lot more than just being quiet in His presence, you know? Real worship, as I said, it's something that's going to engage you fully, right, in some way. And that's just awesome. All right, so here's what I came up with, you know, as kind of my definition of worship. It's to show a literal physical gesture of friendship or affection, to express confidence in and dependence on God when we approach Him. Right? And it's also to show that, you know what, I've surrendered to you, Lord. You know, that getting down on your knees and that, you know, bow, it's a symbol of being surrender to His Lordship. And so, all of this that I just described is all within the context of relationship. See, worship is a function of relationship. If I don't really know Him, I don't really, you know, have experience of His presence and of His love, it's going to be hard for me to really worship. Did you ever notice that? Like, and again, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not trying to you know, be critical. But I think we all understand what it's like if you go into a particular church environment where, you know, they talk about God, right? They read the Bible and do all the things that are, you know, part of the liturgy and whatnot. But there's no passion. There's very little passion in the people there, you know, because why? Because they don't have a relationship with Him. There's something lacking in their experience of God. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like if my worship is not full on, you know, if my worship is not just unrestrained in some way, you know, and just completely, I'm not completely engaged, you know what it tells me? That I've lost something in my relationship with Him. Because when you know Him and you've experienced who He is, oh my gosh, it's easy. You remember what David said when his wife,
Michal,
was that how you say that?
Yeah.
It was Michael.
Mike.
Us Americans, we call her Michael.
But
you know, when he came, you know, with the Ark of the Covenant, right? What did it say? He took off his outer garments and he's running around in his undershirt, basically, you know, the ephod. And his wife looks at that and says, "Oh, look at how you distinguished yourself today, my husband, the king." And what did David say? "I will be even more undignified than this because he's worthy." Right? He had experienced so much of the Father's presence that no expression was too much in his worship of God. I like that. Man, I like that. And I'm so thankful that he's given us that freedom. Right? Come on. I mean, again, I'm trying not to sound critical, but guys, I lived in those liturgical settings. I lived even in, you know, I've been in some charismatic churches where everybody was just kind of like sitting like bumps on a log and really, you know what I'm saying?
Warts on a toad.
What's that?
Warts on a toad.
Warts on a toad? Well, I wouldn't go that far. No. Yeah, you're right. But I've been there, and you've been there as well. And to know how God has so blessed us and graced us with the freedom that we have. I'm telling you, I say, God, I know I didn't deserve this. I know I didn't do anything to deserve this, but thank you, you know, that you heard the cry of my heart, and He's heard the cry of your hearts as well for that more, that express it, that there's that that's just there. It's like, God, I want more of you in my experience than what I've had. And thank God there's always more. Woo! All right? So we have this awesome relationship. And Jesus, when he was questioned by the Pharisees as to what's the greatest commandments, right? He said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength."
Amen.
That's what I'm talking about. Fully engaged in worship. Okay?
Yeah.
And I'm telling you guys, we've got to beware of the fact that there's still religious influence that has sway over us. You'll find yourself zoning out at times. You'll find yourself just like, "Oh, it's the same old thing, you know, every week, blah, blah, blah." Trust me, when that happens, you are actually being influenced by a spirit of religion that wants you to check out from the process, that wants you to not be fully engaged in your worship of the Lord. And I'm being honest, I deal with that myself. There's times where I'm like, you know, "Oh, let's see, I'm going to get something to eat after." Right? It happens. And so we've got to be aware that that's out there, that there is this influence. And if you've been in those kind of environments, religious environments, there's still a process of getting free that for many of us has to take place. But my point to you tonight is, if you notice that, if you see that, and you respond to that inside that says, "I want the more," then you have the freedom to not allow that to stop you from what God wants.
Amen.
to receive from you and worship. Isn't that good?
Yes.
He's like, we're complete. In every area of Christian life, the only limitations that we have are between our ears. Right? The only limitations that we have for ourselves are found between our ears. And so God is just helping us to get freer and freer and freer. All right. So here's the question. What catalyzes or motivates or energizes worship? How does it happen? How do we begin to enter into worship? Is it just something that I kind of flip a switch and go, okay, let's worship? What's going on in the spirit realm that actually catalyzes worship, that actually, you know, motivates it and energizes worship for us? Well, I'm going to tell you what I believe it is. 1 John 4:19 says, we love him because he first loved us. See, we are responding.
Oh, yes.
We're responding to him and his presence and his love. That's what really launches us into worship, is having that kind of encounter with him, right? Where because you experience him, you know, and the love that he has for you, the response just flows. It's just a natural thing, right? It's just so cool, right? Ephesians 1:17, Paul writes, and prays that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. See, this is what we're talking about tonight. Your worship, my worship, is going to be empowered and energized and released through revelation. Through revelation. What he reveals of himself to me, I respond to. When I'm in his presence and he begins to minister to me about how faithful he is, and I think about how he's been faithful, what he's done, and all that, oh my gosh, I just begin to, wow! I'm worshiping him out of that revelation of his faithfulness. Okay? This is not, again, I'm trying to help you understand, this is not something that we work up as a religious duty. Okay, I gotta worship now. Let's see, what do I have to do? No, we come into his presence. We're engaged in who he is and what he's saying and releasing. And that just like all of a sudden, bam, flip the switch. He flips the switch. And now I'm in full worship mode because he's so good. Isn't that amazing? It's honestly, guys, it's just like salvation. We couldn't do a thing to save ourselves. We didn't even want to get saved, and we wouldn't have got saved if he hadn't come and began to pour out his grace on us and give us the power to want what he was offering. We're pitiful without him. But aren't you glad we're not without him? Okay? Them days are over. Jesus did say, apart from me, you can do nothing. But guess what? I'm not apart from him. And neither are you, right? So, revelation empowers worship. It flows out of a prophetic encounter with the Father that happens when we approach the Father based on the kind of relationship Jesus had. How did Jesus relate to the Father? Daddy, right? He had this intimate relationship with the Father. And so when we enter into that, knowing him as Abba, knowing him as Papa, knowing him as Daddy, the revelation just flows. And the worship goes as high and as far as it's possible, right? So what exactly does that look like? Well, Jesus goes on to explain, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And the word for spirit, it's really cool because the Greek word there is actually for wind. It's wind, you know? Pneuma is the Greek word, and it means, you know, the wind. And Jesus talked about that, right? It's the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it comes from, where it's going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. If you're born of the Spirit,
You are filled with Him, and basically what happens? Do you know where the wind's going?
No.
Do you know where it's coming from or what it's going to come? You don't know. You don't know. But guess what? He's moving.
Amen.
The wind moves, and we move. He moves, we move. Now, let me be clear. We're not robots, okay? We have the ability to say whether or not we're going to move with Him. But the idea here is that the Holy Spirit is like wind, and He moves wherever He wants. And I can either get on board, or I can be bored. It's just that simple. I'm going to get on board with where He's going, what He's doing. Otherwise, it's going to be any fun. Okay? So God's nature, His essence, is spirit, so our connection with Him must be spirit-based. All right, and so what does that mean? Well, I have to approach Him. I have to be connecting with Him on His terms, not on mine.
Oh wow!
And there's a lot of stuff that's done in the name of worship that didn't come out of the heart of the Father. It kind of came out of what people thought was a good idea. Have you noticed that?
Come on.
There's just a lot of stuff that it's like, really? You've heard me say this before, but the way this room is set up, I've told you before, I hate this, right? Because you weren't made to come into a gathering of God's people and look at the back of somebody's head. You're just not. And someday we're going to fix that. I don't know how we'll do it, but we're going to fix it, right? So we're talking about heart-to-heart, intensely personal and private communion. Right? First Corinthians 6:17 says that the one who joins himself to the Lord is what? One spirit with Him. So we start from the best place. Do you see that? We start from a place of already being fully connected to Him. You can't get any more one with Him than you already are right now. So how come I don't feel one with Him? How come He feels a million miles away? Because you got some stuff going on up here that's lying to you about what's true. We all deal with that, right? We have feelings. We have a bad day or a bad week and whatnot. And you feel like God's a million miles away. Well, guess what? It's not true. We are fully forever one with Him. And so we start from that place of intimacy. We don't have to strive and sweat and strain to get into His presence or to see His face or to have experiences with Him. You know what? Go back and watch the two messages that Joe Lascano shared here. They're on the website as well. The Inner Life with God. You want to get some real deep training on what that looks like, because he did an amazing job. Don't you agree?
Yeah,
it was awesome. So we're one with Him. There's no separation. Romans 8:16 says that the Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. So we're one, we're fully accepted by the Father. You're welcome with open arms into His presence. How many of you ever had the experience of climbing into His lap and just resting your head on His chest? Man, if you haven't done that, you need to say, Papa, I want that. Because that's real. That is absolutely real. You are His beloved child. And He wants you to experience what that feels like. To have His arms around you and you sit in His lap and just experience the security of that place, right? In Romans 8 again, it says that the Spirit helps our weaknesses, because we don't know how to pray as we should. But the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. What is that? Do you know that the Holy Spirit is with you and in you and upon you to enable you to worship the Father the way He wants to be worshipped? See, this is the thing that I think a lot of the church still hasn't caught up with. That the Father actually has preferences concerning how He wants to be worshipped. Really? Yes. And a lot of what's been Cold worship never came from his heart. It has nothing to do with what he wants. Okay? So we have this unfailing partnership with Holy Spirit to help us worship the way Papa wants to be worshiped. Alright? 2 Corinthians 3, 17 and 18 says, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what?
Freedom.
Liberty!
Freedom."
They say in Brazil, liberdade. I love that word. Yeah, freedom. So, and as we do that, we get transformed more and more into that image of Christ that Paul talks about. So we're talking about life-changing freedom that's involved in worship when we worship in spirit and in truth. Life-changing. Let me tell you, God can do more in a moment when we are engaged in worship than it might take you years other ways to accomplish.
Wow.
He set us free in a second.
Yes.
Just by worshiping him with all that we have. Right? Because we're totally abandoned, totally surrendered, totally engaged in who he is. Right? So, Jesus said, you got to worship in spirit and in truth. Right? And remember, he was talking to this Samaritan woman. And the Samaritans, they came from the Jewish tree, I guess the Jewish family line, but they broke off. And they started to have their own traditions, their own ideas about what worship was. They only said that the first five books of the Old Testament were really God's word. Everything else was not. So they were pretty much stuck with just a piece of the revelation that God had given, you know, in the scriptures. That's all they had, right? So, you know, when Jesus is talking to her and talking about worship, she goes, well, listen, we worship here. You Jews think you should worship on the mountain in Jerusalem. She's trying to defend her religious worship practices as being the only right ones. Does that sound familiar? How many churches you go in today and they'll tell you, well, the way we do it is the way to do it? Seriously, right? That's what she was doing. She was basically saying, no, this, listen, we know. So what does Jesus say? He says to her, you worship what you don't know. We Jews worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But check this out. Oh, my gosh. But an hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people, the Father seeks to be his worshipers. Do you see what happened here? He's talking to her, and he's comparing two aspects of worship. He says, you Samaritans, you worship what you don't even know. You don't even know what you're worshiping, because all you got is the first five books, and that's it. So you don't know much about what you're worshiping. And we Jews, well, we worship what we know. He uses the word what twice. You don't know what you worship, and the Jews, we know what we worship. And then he flips it and says, Father's not looking for a what. He's looking for a who. He's looking for a who. He's looking for a people whose heart is fully his, right? So when you think about worshiping, you know, the Father in spirit and in truth, in reality, suddenly all these other things that are out there that people say are worship start to come into real clear focus. You know? Do you know how much superstition exists in the church that's proclaimed as worship? How about this? If you say to somebody, you know, you don't have to have your church service on a Sunday morning. In some circles, you can be excommunicated. Well, what do you mean? Sunday morning is what church is supposed to have. No. You know, for someone to believe that that's the only time to have church, that's a superstition. There's no scriptural precedent for that. Bible specifically says each person can pick whatever day they want. Just stick to it. You know, just be faithful with whatever you're going to do. Okay? How about this? In some churches, you're not considered holy unless you come dressed a certain way. then that's how you worship God. You know, thank God. I'm like, yes. The dress code is a superstition. That if you don't come dressed in your Sunday best, you're not honoring God. Hello. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt wear your three-piece suit and your finest gown when thou comest to worship me. Oh, that's not the Bible. Okay. How about this idea of keeping silent, reverential silence in the church?
Come on.
You heard that one?
Come on.
That's a mark of holiness, being silent and reverential, right? That's a superstition. Do you know? You know, in Revelation it says that there was only silence in heaven for what? A half hour. It says in Revelation, there's silence in heaven for a half hour. That's it. The rest of the time, they were all having fun worshiping, and they were having their worship party. Okay? Even the idea of a liturgy or order of service has become a superstition in the church. That it has to be done this way. There's a processional, you know, there's an opening prayer, there's the first hymn, there's whatever. All these things. Listen, I grew up that way. I grew up as a Lutheran. And so I'm very familiar with the liturgical form of worship. And again, I'm not trying to say that you can't encounter God in these ways. But none of this was ever in his heart. It's become a superstition. It's become something that you have to do. Why?
Well, because somebody said we have to.
Really, that's all it ever is, right? You know, again, the chairs, the way they're set up, the way the platform is set up, none of this is in the Word. None of this matters to the Lord. You understand that, right? So, truth, worshiping Him, you know, in truth, has to do with what's real, right? Are you worshiping Him out of a heart that is being real in what you're doing? Or are you being influenced by culture, right? I mean, you've been to churches where people, they without even thinking, amen, hallelujah.
The world is ending, amen. The world is ending, amen.
The world is ending, amen. It's like it's become this pattern, this, you know, this kind of thing that people just do without even realizing. It's a religious speak, I guess you would call it, right? But it's not real. It's not coming out of their heart. You know? I mean, I'll be honest with you. That when we first started doing Heaven's Invasion, you know, I was used to that. I was used to people responding.
Amen! Hallelujah, brother!
You know, really, I honestly was. And so it, like, kind of threw me for a while. I said, Lord, these people don't do anything. What's going on? You know? And he basically showed me was that, you know, son, I'm speaking in their hearts. You know, they're getting it. Just because they're not doing the religious thing. Oh, religious thing, yes. Thank you. Okay. You know, and I mean, listen. People will go through the motions of worship because it's expected. Because that's what you do. Okay? Come into church, you know, and in some churches you got to genuflect, you got to do all these different things and whatnot. You know, and it's like a simulation. You know what I mean? You know what a simulation is? It's not real. You know, when pilots get trained to fly a plane, they have to go to a simulator and actually practice. They're not really flying a plane. And so for a lot of folks, worship is a simulation. You know, the Lord talked about this in Isaiah 29. He says, this people draws near with their words and honors me with their lip service, but they've removed their hearts far from me. You know, so it's just going through the motions, right? You can also have folks that deliberately want to show off in their worship. You notice that? You know, I want people to really know that I'm a worshiper. But it's not coming from their heart. It's designed basically to make you believe something. You know, that they're, I'm a super worshiper. Whatever. Okay? And then, you know, the last thing would be basically doing certain things because everybody's doing them. You know? And You know, that was so appealing for so many years, where we would deliberately look at how people responded to certain kinds of music or cultural expressions, and we'd bring them into the church. Okay? So certain music styles, you know, I'll never forget the first time we tried to do hip-hop. And I got nothing wrong with hip-hop. You know, there's some good stuff out there. But can I tell you, you can't worship the hip-hop.
Amen.
Am I the only one that thinks that? Is anybody really able to worship the hip-hop? You can?
No, I was agreeing.
Oh.
Amen, brother. Pre-
Thank you.
You
can have fun with it.
You can have fun with it, absolutely. You know, and there's times, yeah, where, you know, we would, you know, throw out something, you know, like that. I mean, who remembers the days, honestly, of Kirk Franklin?
Uh-huh.
And
yeah.
You Want a Revolution? Ooh. I mean, those are fun songs. But you're not worshiping God with that stuff. You're just not, you know. Believe me, I went through that. All I got to do is ask, you know, my kids about week after week trying to lead worship in a Christian school and trying to motivate. Remember those days? It was like, woo, help me, Jesus. You know, but that's what I'm trying to say, is that, you know, bringing in these kinds of things just because they happen to be cool, right? It's got to come from the heart.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. The Lord, and we'll talk about this next week, because I don't want to do it tonight because it's just going to take too much. But we're going to talk next week about how every single one of us has opportunity to release something from our heart in worship that will radically change what happens here and what God does here. Okay? It's like, it's a multiplication factor. How many of you have received prophecy from a team who's come and prophesied over you? Ever had that? Anybody?
Yeah.
You receive prophecy from a team, okay?
Uh-huh.
And compare that with what it's like when one person comes and shares prophecy. It's good, but how much more did you get when you had five or six people who were tag teaming? Right? And just really releasing what God was showing them. Someone said that something. Oh, yeah. God willing, you know, you jump off of what they said. It's powerful. And God wants us to do that in worship.
Wow.
Not tag team prophecy, but how about tag team worship?
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Where you do something and it so inspires me because it came out of your heart to the Father that all of a sudden, wow, we just went a whole other level. Because you got real and released what God put in you.
Amen. That's good.
See, this is where God's trying to take us. And for some of us, it's going to be a stretch because we got to break out of that mindset of, okay, lead me in worship. I'm here. All right. Okay. So I think I'll stop there for tonight. Any questions? Was that at all helpful?
Yes.
It's been a while since I shared on worship, and it just kind of felt like this was a good time to do that. Yes.
The one time I was talking to God about worship, you know, and he said something very interesting to me, you know. He said, son, worship is like lovemaking. There is a reciprocal expression of love that, like he was saying before, you know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, with, you know, with all that we are, with your heart means with your love, with your passions, you know, with your mind means with your thinking, with what you think about God, you know, with your soul, with all your emotions getting involved, and with your strength, is with your body, physically, you know? So, that's it.
Wow.
Lovemaking.
Yeah, there you go.